series of talks. These talks are to showcase our amazing researchers and to give them the opportunity to share their research and the science that they are so passionate about. So today we bring you Dougal. He is a PhD student at the University of Sydney and the CSIRO using radio telescopes to follow up on gravitational wave events. In 2017, he was involved in the follow-up of the first neutron star merger, GW170817. And over the past year, he has led follow-up of gravitational wave events with the Australia Telescope Compact Array, as well as the Australian Square Kilometer Array Pathfinder. He is also making the most of his last few months in isolation by reigniting his passion for cooking. He declares that he has not, you know, mastered one thing, but has become really good at a variety of things. So today his talk will be bursts, jets, and waves, probing the universe with gravitational waves and light. During this talk, in the chat box on YouTube, you can write in your questions, and at the end of Dougal's talk, we will pass those on to him. So please sit back and enjoy this talk by Dougal. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Jackie. So as she said, as she said, I'm a PhD student at the University of Sydney, and what I do is use radio telescopes to search for the electromagnetic radiation that gets produced when two compact objects merges together. These mergers are among the most violent and explosive events in the universe, and we can use them to tell us about all sorts of things, including how fast the universe is expanding, where heavy elements like gold and platinum come from, and how matter behaves in the most extreme environments. So on the 17th of August, 2017, the Fermi Gamma Ray Burst Monitor detected a burst of gamma rays lasting about 2 seconds and issued an alert to astronomers around the world. Now, Fermi detects these things basically every day, so it wasn't any, you know, cause for concern or excitement. But what set this one apart was that 1.7 seconds earlier, the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory, or LIGO, detected gravitational waves coming from the same area of sky. And these gravitational waves were consistent with what theorists predict a neutron star merger should produce. So I'm going to show you a little video here, and what we're going to see is the spectrogram of the gravitational wave. So how it behaves in amplitude, or like how loud it is, and frequency, or how fast the wave is oscillating as a function of time. We're also going to hear the gravitational wave converted into sound waves. So there's no adjustment to this signal in terms of pitching up or down. This is exactly what you would hear if your ears could actually listen to the gravitational waves. So here we go. You can see the gravitational waves increase in frequency as the neutron stars get closer and closer together. They eventually wash 1.7 seconds later. Before we get too far ahead of ourselves, let's go back to basics. So what are gravitational waves and how can we detect them? Let's go even more basic than that and ask, what is gravity? I'm sure you've all heard the story of Isaac Newton sitting under his apple tree, getting hit in the head with a falling apple, coming up with the idea of gravity. And his idea was essentially that if you have two objects that have mass, they get attracted to one another. And he quantified it using the equation that I've got up on the slides there. Basically, it says that the gravitational force between two objects is given by some constant number that we don't have to worry about. You multiply that by the mass of object one, multiply by the mass of object two, and then divide it by the square of the distance in between them. And so if you double the mass of one of the objects, you can double the force. If you halve the distance between them, the force quadruples. And it's all fairly simple in the scheme of things. But it's turned out to be incredibly accurate. So accurate that for hundreds of years, we didn't think we needed any improvement to Newton's theories. But then in 1915, Albert Einstein came along and he noticed that there was a few things that Newton's theories didn't perfectly explain. And he came up with this idea that instead of being caused by the attraction between two objects or anything like that, gravity is actually caused by the mass of an object warping the space around it. And so this initially, you know, might seem like one of those theoretical physics things that, you know, it sounds really cool and it's good to be very accurate about our understanding of the universe and all that, but it doesn't really, you know, change your day-to-day life or anything. You know, even NASA used Newtonian physics to put man on the moon. So, you know, why even bother with all these complicated equations when we can just use Newton's simple ones? And the answer to that is that there's a lot of things that we take for granted today that use general relativity and Einstein's theories. And a good example of that is GPS. So GPS uses the signals transmitted from satellites orbiting the Earth to work out where you are on the Earth. And turns out the difference between Einstein's theories and Newton's theories would result in a positional error of about 10 kilometers per day, making GPS completely useless. The other thing that general relativity's caused us to sort of build is Wi-Fi. So Wi-Fi was developed by radio astronomers at the CSIRO, just like myself. They were searching for miniature black holes. Now, Einstein's theory of general relativity was basically what came up with the concept of black holes. If we didn't have Einstein come along and blow Newton out of the water, we wouldn't have had this idea of black holes. We wouldn't have searched for miniature black holes, and we wouldn't have Wi-Fi, and I wouldn't be able to talk to you today. So let's now move on to gravitational waves. So they basically what happens when you take the curvature of space-time that we talked about and just move that curvature, it ripples through space. So if you take two black holes like we've done here and put them in orbit around one another, their mass causes gravitational waves to be produced. Now, we know that energy must be conserved. So if you radiate away energy in the form of gravitational waves, you must lose kinetic energy from your orbit. And so your orbit slowly decays. Black holes get closer and closer and closer together until they eventually merge. And you'll also see that as they get closer, the frequency of the waves increases, and so does the amplitude, just like we saw in the spectrogram earlier. So we can actually detect these ripples in space-time using this thing called an interferometer. So we start with a high-power laser. We split it along two perpendicular arms, and at the end of each arm, there's a mirror that kind of reflects the laser back towards the beam splitter, binds the things back together. We can then look at the interference pattern that that produces. And if the arms are precisely the same length, we should see the same signal that we started with. But if they're two slightly different distances, the two beams will destructively interfere and get a different signal, just like we can see here. And so ultimately, you can use this to measure the length along each arm, accurate to less than the width of a proton. So it's basically the most accurate ruler in the universe. And now a change of length along one of the arms like this could be due to something like an earthquake. It could be even due to, you know, a truck driving by the detector. So there's a lot of work, thousands of people working towards, you know, characterizing these signals and removing all the boring stuff that we don't care about so that astronomers like me can focus on the interesting changes, which are when a gravitational wave passes by us. So let's move on to something that may seem completely unrelated, short gamma ray bursts. And as with a lot of names in astronomy, this is very much a case of what you see is what you get. A short gamma ray burst, or GRB, is literally just a short burst of gamma radiation. Pretty simple. So there's a long history of gamma ray bursts, starting all the way back in the 1960s, when the US military developed Project Vela, which was to detect nuclear detonations. And it was basically enforcing the ban on testing nuclear weapons. And part of that project involved launching a series of satellites capable of detecting gamma radiation into the atmosphere. And gamma radiation is one of the sort of signatures of what a nuclear bomb would produce. So as well as detecting, you know, the handful of tests that maybe shouldn't have been happening, it also detected other bursts of gamma radiation, which were clearly different. And at the time, not much was really thought of these. They were able to trace some of them to being from the sun, but there was a lot that were clearly not from the sun, not from the earth. They weren't really a threat, so they kind of just filed them away and, you know, decided we'll come back to them when we've got, you know, less on our plate. And so about a decade later, scientists at Los Alamos Laboratory looked through the catalogue of these bursts and deduced that they definitely weren't from the Earth or the Sun, and they actually came from somewhere outside of the solar system. And in the 50 or so years since then, we've launched many space telescopes with the goal of finding more of these gamma ray bursts, and now we're up to thousands of them. And this plot here shows bursts detected by the SWIFT telescope, which can operate at both gamma ray and X-ray wavelengths. And you can see this is the first 1,000 that it's detected, overlaid onto an image of the Milky Way. You may also be able to see the small and large Magellanic clouds down in the bottom right there. What you can see is that all the bursts are evenly distributed across the sky. So it tells us that they don't come from the Milky Way. If they came from the Milky Way, we expect to see more closer to the plane of the Milky Way, but instead they're sort of all over the place. And that tells us that they come from distant galaxies. But what actually are they? Well, ultimately, gamma ray bursts are caused by some kind of central engine, some kind of explosion that launches a huge jet of material into space at close to the speed of light, like you can see in this left image here. The collision of that material with the surrounding environment and with itself causes gamma rays to be emitted. And eventually, as the jet sort of slows down, it produces this afterglow with X-rays, visible light, and radio waves. And so the natural question to ask is, you know, what actually causes that jet to be produced? And it turns out that gamma ray bursts aren't just one thing. There's at least two different types. So if you make a plot that shows how long each burst lasts, you get something that looks like the graph I have on the right here. So there's clearly one type that lasts about, you know, tens of seconds to a couple of minutes. And we call those long gamma ray bursts because, you know, what you see is what you get. They go for longer, we'll call them long. Then there's these short gamma ray bursts that last about less than a second. And the cutoff between the two is, you know, roughly around 2 seconds or so. Now, astronomers have long known that long gamma ray bursts are produced by a type of supernova. And the way we've known that is that in 1998, a supernova and a GRB were detected at the same time, at the same place. And since then, we've detected many others that are, you know, the same thing. You get a supernova and a GRB, a long GRB at the same time. Clearly, that's what the cause is. But it wasn't until the detection of GW170817 that we were able to show that neutron star mergers are the origin of short gamma rays. It was sort of predicted that that's probably the cause, but nobody had been able to prove it for sure. So that brings us back to where we started, the story of GW170817. One of the downsides of gravitational wave detectors is that they're really, really bad at pinpointing where mergers actually come from. So are gamma ray telescopes. And this animation shows the localization of GW170817 by gamma ray telescopes, and then by our gravitational wave detectors, LIGO and Virgo. This may look like a relatively small area of sky, but to cover it all with a normal telescope would take hundreds or thousands of observations. It's just not feasible. So instead, what we can do is target known galaxies in that area of sky. We hope that the merger occurred in one of those. And ultimately, for this event, we were right. And about 11 hours after the gravitational wave signal was detected, astronomers were able to find this optical afterglow in the galaxy NGC 4993. And they thought that wasn't there before. This could be it. And so everyone around the globe swung their telescopes to have a look at that. Now, what I've got here is the sort of timeline of that effort. Now, electromagnetic radiation spans a huge spectrum, from the high-frequency gamma rays that we talked about all the way down to low-frequency radio waves. And Reinhold talked about this in his live stream about a month ago, and the video is up on the OzGrav YouTube channel. So if you want a sort of more detailed explanation of what I'm about to say, you should definitely go check that out. But basically, different parts of the spectrum can tell us different things. So if you think about in terms of visible light, like you see with your eyes, if you could only see the color red, you'd be able to see things that are red, like fire trucks or, you know, autumn leaves or whatever. But you wouldn't be able to see anything like, you know, grass that's green. And so you're missing out on all of that information there. You can only see one very tiny part of what's happening around you. And you can apply that principle to astronomy. If you look at only one type of radiation, say the visible optical light, you're missing out on a wealth of information. That's why it was so important that we pointed every kind of telescope at this merger to see what we could find. Now, within a few hours, we were able to detect ultraviolet and infrared light coming from the merger. And what that tells us is that this event wasn't like a normal short gamma ray burst that we've detected before, where the jet is pointing sort of directly towards us. But then our X-ray telescopes and radio telescopes didn't see anything for a week or two. And that's not what you'd expect if the jet's pointing sort of away from us. And so that's kind of ruled out this event as being like anything that we've detected previously. Now, when I say that we pointed all of our telescopes at the merger, that wasn't an exaggeration or anything. It was basically every major telescope on Earth was pointing at this thing. So this plot here shows that the sort of distribution of all the telescopes involved, and as well as all of these ones, there was about 10 in space as well. So you can see they're spread out across every continent on Earth, even Antarctica. The green dots represent optical telescopes. So you can see there's a lot down in South America because they've got very good weather up in their mountains for sort of building optical observatories. You can see over in Australia all of the orange dots, which correspond to radio telescopes. The person power required to carry out this work was also enormous. So the blue shading there sort of represents the number of people from each country that were involved in this. You can see there's a pretty large contingent of people from Australia, but overall it was a couple of thousand people. So we've never really had anything like this happen in astronomy before. We're trying to work with, you know, a few thousand people from all across the planet. It was really, really exciting stuff. Now, I was one of the few thousand people involved in the follow-up, which is quite lucky. I was at the very start of my PhD, so it was very much a, you know, right time, right place kind of thing for me. And my role involved searching for radio emission with the Australia Telescope Compact Array, you can see in the top right there. We were working with international teams using telescopes in the US and in India as well, basically just searching for any kind of radio emission from this merger. And so what happened on the 17th of August was I got a call quite early in the morning, well beyond the time I normally wake up at, saying this thing had happened. Initially, I was kind of like, this can't be real, surely. But I had to rush over to the telescope control room at the CSRO and sort of start helping out with observing. We spent all day there observing, reducing the data, you know, emailing other astronomers, reading all the alerts that we were getting from other telescopes, all this kind of stuff. It was one of the most intense things that I've ever done. It was a good 20 hours of work and then months of work afterwards to sort of keep observing this thing and writing up papers and communicating with everyone else about what we'd found. So no rush to do this anytime soon. So we continued observing this thing every few days until we eventually did find radio emission about 2 weeks after the merger. And from then on, we monitored it regularly. And that's what I'm showing over on the right here. You can see the emission is denoted by the little crosshairs just above the main source there. And you can see that initially the afterglow brightens. And then at about 150 days, it starts to fade away. And it's now over 1,000 days since the event, and we still observe it once or twice a year. Our next observations, I think, are in September. Basically just seeing if it's, you know, happened to sort of pop up again. We're not sure if it will, but it's worth checking. Now, the radio emission from the merger is really important. As I said, if you look at different colors of light, you get different information. So the radio emission that you see is one of the only ways to determine how much energy the merger actually released and the way it actually released. So based on the rise and fall that we saw, we were able to determine that it was produced by a jet that got launched into the sort of material around the binary at close to the speed of light. And the jet sort of collides with the material surrounding the merger and eventually manages to break out. Now, as it continues propagating, it starts to slow down and sort of expand. And that's why we see the emission start to fade away as well. So we can use the sort of time scale and how bright things get and all that kind of stuff to pin down this energetics of the merger. And we can also use radio telescopes to determine that the jet wasn't pointing towards us. It was pointing about 20 degrees away from us, which is important for other areas of science as well. Now, this event has lots of implications for physics, and I could spend, you know, hours talking about all of them. But unfortunately, I'm already pushing my time quite a bit here. So I've already mentioned that we confirmed the neutron star merger short gamma ray burst association. We've also managed to confirm Einstein's prediction that gravitational waves travel at the speed of light. So the fact that the merger and the GRB that we detected were only 1.7 seconds apart tells us that they took roughly the same time to travel. Now, 1.7 seconds sounds like a big delay, but this merger took place about 120 million light years away. The 1.7 seconds out of 120 million years isn't, you know, much at all. We're pretty certain that, once again, as usual, Einstein was correct. One of the other cool things that we can do is use optical telescopes and look at the different colors of visible light that the merger produced and use that to determine the elements that actually make up the material ejected by the merger. And so this plot here shows a periodic table of the elements that are shaded corresponding to what produces the elements that we have on Earth and in the solar system. And it's been long predicted that a lot of the heavy elements we have here on Earth are formed by neutron star mergers. And basically, it's a neutron star merger. All this material gets blown out into space, and some of it gets caught up in our sort of solar system formation. Some of it ends up in the Earth. That theory was confirmed by GW170817. We now know where all the gold and all the platinum and all the heavy stuff that we have here on Earth comes from. And in fact, the merger actually produced 10 times the mass of the Earth in just gold and platinum alone. So you can imagine, you know, how much money that would all be worth. So what about the future? So we found out a lot about GW170817. That's only just one event. And there's still a lot that we don't know. For example, one of the things that most interests me is that neutron stars, we know, have a range of masses. GW170817 is sort of a fairly average mass binary, but what kind of radiation will a lighter binary produce, or a heavier one? Or what happens if we have the merger of a neutron star and a black hole? And what's left over from these mergers? For GW170817, we think there was a really heavy neutron star that formed, and then it would have collapsed down into a black hole. But do lighter mergers form stable neutron stars? Do heavier mergers form black holes? There's lots and lots of questions, and there's only one way to find out and answer them, and that's to basically keep looking. So we now have a series of radio telescopes across the globe, ready and waiting for another neutron star merger to be detected. And as Jackie said at the start of this talk, I've been leading observations with the Compact Array and with ASCAP, or the Australian Square Kilometre Array Pathfinder. And some of you might be thinking, you know, why do you need two radio telescopes? Isn't that a little bit greedy or something? And the reason is that ASCAP is really special. It's not like any other radio telescope on the Earth. The reason it's special is that it can survey huge areas of sky at once. So you point it at the sky and you get an image that covers about the same area as the entire Southern Cross. And so that's great for this kind of work where we've got our gravitational wave detectors say, you know, you've got a neutron star merger happening somewhere in that patch of sky. Go find it. We can point ASCAP at it and basically survey the entire area at once. Whereas with a normal telescope, like an optical telescope, or even with the compact array, you can only get a tiny fraction of that area at once. And so it's much, much better for finding, you know, for surveying these large localization areas. And we switch to telescopes like the compact array when we localize something. We want really sensitive observations instead. And on that note, just to sort of finish up, there's this really cool tour that's been developed by the CSIRO that lets you actually visit the site that ASCAP is on. It's in the absolute middle of nowhere, so there's not really much opportunity to visit in person. It's something like an 8-hour drive from Perth. But if you go to this website here, you can jump on and sort of take a flying tour. You can walk around some of the antennas. And it's something that, you know, if you've got a couple of minutes, definitely recommend checking it out. That brings me to the end of my talk. So thank you very much. And I'm very much looking forward to answering your questions.
All right. Thank you so much, Dougal. That was a great talk. And yes, I would definitely encourage people to go ahead to that virtual tour of the radio observatory, because I've done that before and it's quite fascinating.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. So one question we had was, why was the gamma ray burst 1.7 seconds after the gravitational wave signal?
The short answer to that is we don't know. The long answer is that it could be that there was sort of propagation effects. So space isn't a perfect vacuum. The gamma rays have to travel through something. And there's a chance that there could have maybe been stuff sort of along the way that's slowed it down, whereas the gravitational waves just propagate at the speed of light. The other option could be that it's an inherent thing that the gamma ray burst, the jet that causes it, isn't launched until, you know, a few moments after the merger. So it might be that the merger happens and then there's a delay and then there's the jet that happens.
Okay.
And that, you know, it's hard to tell with one event. We need to go search for more.
Hopefully there'll be more events so we have a bigger sample to answer some of these questions.
Fingers crossed, yeah.
Yeah. So we'll just go with one more question. And so, you know, as a scientist early in his career, hopefully you've thought about this. What possible future discovery are you most excited about?
I think one of the things that excites me the most is having a large sample of these events. So to do things like answer those questions that I've mentioned. But with that, you can also, if you have a large enough sample of them and that are localized to galaxies, we know exactly where they happened, you can actually use those as a sort of standard candle to measure how fast the universe is expanding. And so that's something that over the next probably, I mean, hopefully 10 years, but probably more like 20 or 30 years, we'll be able to do. We're able to, you know, figure out the origin of the universe, essentially.
All right, great. So what we're going to do is, all thank you from our respective places in which we watch this. And in 2 more weeks, we are going to have another talk. This will be at 3 p.m. on the 15th of June. And our early career researcher Avi from Monash University will be giving a talk. Nobody has time for that. Making galaxy simulations in hours instead of years with parallel computing. So that will be a really interesting look at the computational side of astrophysics research. So again, thank you, Dougal, for that talk. And this talk will remain on YouTube, so you can go watch it at your leisure. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.